Good morning. I am going to Kenya this week. In fact, when you see this, I will be in Kenya on safari. My sister is a nurse practitioner, and she is volunteering at an orphanage in a town called Katali, north of Nairobi. And she's there for 2 months. Her two-month service period is up, and she's leaving. And so she invited me to go on safari with her on her way out of country. And, you know, YOLO. Except, you know, can I just say, YOLO really means you oughta look out. So, we are going to do all of this on a YouTube video. So the first thing you need to do is get your notebook out, because I don't know how to work the chalkboard thing on this. I need you to get your notebook out, and we're going to do some, you're going to have to take notes on what I'm going to say. So the first thing you need to do, and one of the beauties of this is that you get to pause it if you need to. There's no additional quotations this week, but you do have a literary term. So go to your literary term page and write down this word, didacticism. It is spelled D-I-D-A-C-T-I-C-I-S-M. And that is the practice of valuing literature, or anything really, primarily for its instructional content. So we're going to be practicing some didacticism in almost everything we read, but certainly in reading Crime and Punishment. There's a lot of instructional content. Well, you know, there's instructional content in most things that we'll be reading. Because we're reading classics, and we'll talk about the definition of classics in just a few moments. So didacticism is the practice of valuing literature and other things primarily for its instructional content. Okay, then go to your vocabulary page. The first vocabulary term is amiable, A-M-I-A-B-L-E. It's an adjective, and it means friendly. It's nice to be amiable. Amiable people are very likable. The next word is contentious, C-O-N-T-E-N-T-I-O-U-S. And that another adjective, and it means quarrelsome. So yeah, nobody likes a contentious person because they're always wanting to quarrel. And then the next word is malign, M-A-L-I-G-N. That's an adjective meaning having an evil disposition towards others. It's also commonly used as a verb. And that meaning is to speak evil of. So malign has two definitions. The first as an adjective, meaning having an evil disposition towards others. The next one is a verb, meaning to speak evil of. Don't malign your friends because they're your friends. Okay. Actually, don't malign anybody. Okay, so that's it. Although now that we, you know, we talked about what idioms are, it'd be kind of fun to learn some new ones. Here's a new one, and you might find this on a quiz. Come home to roost. Have you ever heard that idiom? It's sort of like the definition is kind of, not definition, but the meaning is kind of like it's a boomerang effect. Something that you've done has a boomerang where it comes back to you. It has very disagreeable repercussions. That is what come home to roost means. Okay, that's all your memory work for today. It's really actually hard for me to do these because I can't bounce off you. I can't talk, you know, you can't give me your insight on some of the things we're going to be talking about. All right, I wanted to review the worldviews because I forgot to give you that assignment, right? To compose your own worldview. So you're going to have to do that this week. Do November 15th. And I shall be back from Safade. All right, let's go back to our worldviews and how to write a worldview. And let's just review them. If you'll get out your notes on worldviews. Oh my gosh, I look a wreck because I just woke up. I'm actually doing this and it's 5:30 in the morning. Okay, so we have theism is a worldview, meaning that is actually a belief in the existence of one God, viewed as the creative source of the human race and the world, who transcends yet is immanent in the world. It's beyond everything, but he's here. Deism believes in a God of nature, a non-interventionist creator who just lets the universe run itself according to natural laws. So people who believe that God created the world and then just kind of set it in motion and let it go, they would be deists. Romanticists believe that God is nature and is inherently good. And then that's how human intuition replaces the Holy Spirit. Truth and good are relative and changing. Naturalism is the view of the world that takes account only of natural elements and forces. It excludes any supernatural or spiritual, and only the laws of nature have any force. Realism is similar to naturalism. The world has no purpose. Reality is only that which can be experienced, measured, and replicated. Absurdism, everything is disorganized. Explaining the cosmos is abandoned. There's no point. And absurdists just don't care because to them there's just no point. Existentialists believe that each of us create our own meaning of our life. And we are going to read a book like that. And that is as opposed to it's being created for us by a deity. And our lives are, and it's also as opposed to our lives being defined by theological definitions or doctrines. So we kind of make up our own life as we go along. What we think is important. Postmodernism, as I said, is arguably the most depressing philosophy ever to spring from the Western mind. And it's difficult to talk about, as I said in class, because nobody really understands it. It is absolutely, it's impossible to articulate. But basically what it says is that we've reached an end point in human history. Originality is dead. All religions and visions are dead. Revolution is dead. Basically what they're saying is, like it or not, we are stuck in a permanent crisis of meaning, a dark room from which we can never escape. So you'll see, you know, it's very atheistic. You'll see this atheistic, postmodernistic, absurdist kind of worldview as we read Crime and Punishment. But what's interesting you have to keep in mind is that Dostoevsky is a deist. So, and a Christian. Okay. Wait a minute. He's a theist. I got that mixed up. Because deism believes that God was present, but is no longer present. As opposed to theism, which believes, which says that we have a God who is very present, that all human life is sacred, we're created in the image of God. That's theism. Deism says that the world is like a clock wound up by God many years ago, but now he's absent. The clock, which would be like the world, is present. God is absent. Now, it doesn't mean... And deists also believe that his absence was his decision. Crazy. Okay. Where's my... So, when you write your worldview, what you're gonna, in your composition, you know, it just doesn't have to be very long, you need to include your views on things like authority. Is the Bible important to you? Do you obey God and other authority, your parents, you know, the policeman, even when it's uncomfortable to do that? What's your feelings on authority? The second thing is pleasure. What do you really enjoy doing? Does it please God? Is it important that it pleases God? Third, fate. Who or what really determines your life? Chance? Circumstances? God? And then fourth, justice. What are the consequences of our actions? Is there some sort of judgment? Do bad people suffer? Why do good people suffer? It's going to be interesting for you to consider these things as you read Crime and Punishment. You're going to have to consider, what is truth? What is goodness? All right, let's talk about Dostoevsky. He's really kind of a very interesting man. As with many great writers, you know, he was struggled and he was torn. Alright, Fyodor Mikhailovich Dostoevsky. You can figure out how to spell it by looking at your book. He was born in 1821, died in 1881. And he was born in Moscow on October 30th. So we just missed his birthday. I think it was like 56, but I mean... It says he was 60 when he died. He was the second child of an overly domineering father and an extremely subservient mother. The father was a upper-class doctor, and he forced Dostoevsky into studying military engineering. And until the father was murdered by one of his own serfs, you know, he had property and people worked on the property, farming it. So one of his sort of employees murdered him. Until that time, Dostoevsky was very obedient. The killing, however, gave the young man some imagination, and although he went to school as a military engineer and he became a sub-lieutenant, the killing gave him some fodder to work with to write things like Crime and Punishment. And he was very attracted to literature, and he gave up his military career and started writing. So this, of course, led him to a great period of poverty, because not all authors get to just write and be rich. He wrote his first book, let's see how old he was. He was when he was 25. And that was called Poor Folks. And you know what? To his credit, it was recognized by critics as a work of pure genius, which he is. He was a genius. And he started writing regularly for a monthly magazine. There's some word that he actually tried to write 10 novels at once. And you know, he could work. He was one of those people who could just work and work and work. But all of a sudden, everything came to a quick stop. He had joined some political group that was a sort of an agitator group, kind of revolutionary. And he'd been taking part in some innocuous discussions about political economy. But word got around. The police were suspicious. And he, with his brother and 30 pals, were arrested in April 1849 and thrown into the fortress of St. Peter and St. Paul and St. Petersburg. And this is an interesting story. So he and a bunch of other people were marched off to the scaffold, and he was getting ready to be hung. He was told to prepare for death. But before the sentence was executed, as they're all standing there shirtless in the shivering, freezing cold, it was announced that all their penalty was being put off, and they were sent to Siberia, which, if you know, in Russia, Siberia is the northernmost part of Russia, and it's freezing cold. And, you know, they didn't treat their prisoners very nicely. So on Christmas Eve, he started on his journey, and the next 4 years were spent among convicts in a prison. And he has described his experiences there in his book, Memories of the House of the Dead. So, of course, these were terrible experiences, but they helped him to come up with a lot of the deeper thoughts. It strengthened his mind. It strengthened his body to survive this hardship and, you know, have time to think, I'm sure, while you're out in the freezing cold, moving rocks around, to think about these things, about what is fair, what is justice, you know, how much do I just want to kill that guard, but how much do I know that that is wrong? So he got out after the 4 years. He was forced into military service for 3 years, which was part of his sentence. And then he married a widow, Madame Isayev, and he resumed his literary career. He was a gambler, which put him in desperate situations often. She died in 1863, and then in the following year, he lost his brother, Michael. And they were very close. They had a little magazine that they would put out. So anyway, now he's been left alone. He continued to write. I'm just wonder if you need to know these. You probably should know that he wrote The Idiot and The Brothers Karamazov. He wrote several other books at this time period too, but those were huge works of literature that are still very important today in literary circles, literary analysis. He married his second wife, who was his stenographer, meaning she took the dictation, she rewrote the books, she rewrote his notes. And she loved him. She took care of him. She was much younger, but I guess it worked for them. He died in 1881 from a lung hemorrhage. He did have epilepsy. It's not known whether the epilepsy contributed to his death. But the people in St. Petersburg were very sad. There was a huge expression of public feeling because he was very popular in his own time. He had a very hard life, and you could see it on his face. And he also hung out with criminals. He had a long history of hanging out with criminals. And so he had this very intense sort of interest in abnormal people and the psychology, which he liked to analyze. And that's in a lot of his books. He is considered among the greatest of Russia's literary geniuses, and Crime and Punishment is his acknowledged masterpiece. And it displays some of his most characteristic ideas. And I want to look up the definition of this so I can have it for you. One of them is expiation. Let's see. That is one of the biggest ideas in his. And the actual definition for that is the act of making amends or reparation for guilt or wrongdoing, like an atonement. So Crime and Punishment is one of the most amazingly convincing and terrifying books in all literature and is considered a literary classic. So let's define what is a literary classic. I have chosen a reading list for you all this year that includes most 99% are literary classics. What is a literary classic and why are they even important? A literary classic is a work of the highest excellence that has something important to say about life and or the human condition and says it with great artistry. A classic, through its enduring presence, has withstood the test of time and is not bound by time or place or customs. So the same work that speaks to you in Northern Virginia would speak to somebody in Mongolia. It speaks to us today as forcefully as it spoke to people 100 or more years ago, and as forcefully as it will speak to people of future generations. For this reason, a classic is said to have universality. Good morning, honey. Oh, thank you. My boarding pass. So, if you need to rewind the tape here and get that definition written down, you need to, because that'll be on future quizzes and you should know why we're reading what we are. What is a literary classic? All right, let's see. You know, there was something about on Dostoevsky's um, had something in here on his. Damn it. All right, well, you can see as you're reading Crime and Punishment what Dostoevsky's time in Siberia in the prison, and then his forced time in military service, the kind of effect it had on him. And that's one of the interesting things, one of the most interesting things about Crime and Punishment is the split character. That we all, you know, we all struggle with things like that. And that's what's so interesting about this. You know, you read it, you're like, oh, I can totally understand that. Let's see what I do with that. I had a really fun thing. We'll do it next week. So we have Dostoevsky, him and his, he and his treasonous friends, after, you know, having to go before, it was a firing squad. They were all standing there outside in the cold, and to suddenly all of a sudden go, just kidding, you're not going to be killed this minute. You're going to go, you've got this reprieve. And actually, you know, it was never intended to kill them. It was just a cruel method to teach these guys a lesson. So the Tsar just, you know, sent them off to Siberia and 4 years in prison. And of course, this haunted him for the rest of his life. So you need to remember that he wrote The Idiot and The Brothers Karamazov. The Brothers Karamazov is considered a masterpiece of Western literature. So one of the really cool things about, well, there's so many really cool things in Crime and Punishment, but he was very specific, very detailed about every little thing. So students were able to go back and measure exactly how many steps Raskolnikov took and determined where, for instance, the bridge is. So Kameny Bridge, there's a bridge that's close to the Haymarket Square that leads from Raskolnikov's room to Alyona Ivanova's apartment. But, you know, Dostoevsky never names the bridge, right? He always just says K, and then nothing after that. K Bridge. Well, an early student identified it incorrectly as Kameny Bridge. But to be historically correct, to get from Raskolnikov's place to Alyona's apartment, you go over the Kukushkin Bridge. So all the streets and the building landmarks are very accurate. He was very careful in his realistic descriptions. And like I was saying, students have measured the distance from Raskolnikov's room to the pawnbroker's flat, and it is actually about 730 paces, which is the same as Raskolnikov counted. To put things into perspective of what he was trying to, how he was trying to deal with the pawnbroker, and what she was giving him for the watch, the main Russian monetary unit is the ruble. And at the time that he wrote the novel, the ruble consisted of 100 kopecks. So 100 kopecks was worth about 50 cents. And so when Raskolnikov pawns his watch for 1.5 rubles, he's getting about 75 cents. So that's not okay. You know, you can understand where he would be so frustrated, especially for something that was so valuable to him. And he was starving. Remember, we talked about poverty being a motive, how it ran through Crime and Punishment, and how it affected everybody, how it was a driving force. It was present in the streets of St. Petersburg, and you can see how the poverty is a driving force for a very hungry Raskolnikov. Marmeladov's title, he's a titular counselor. If you want to know what a titular counselor is, it is someone above a custodian, but not of a very high rank in the rankings in Russian society. And the yellow ticket that they talk about is in Russia, prostitutes in Russia and most European countries at that time were required to register with the police and carry a permit, which was a yellow identity card. If you were a prostitute, you had to register. Hey, Michael, can I get you to get me a cup of coffee? You mind? Just a K-cup. Thank you. One of the most important things in here is the split personality, split characteristics that we see in Raskolnikov. But so in chapter 6 in part 1, he had overheard a conversation. And it's part of his justification for murdering Alyona Ivanova. I know how to say that. I just have to see the video again. Or actually, I have if you can remember, I have a pronunciation guide for them. So he had overheard this conversation. And the ideas that he heard were not Raskolnikov's, they were not Dostoevsky's ideas, but they are a kind of conglomeration of a German philosopher named Hegel. And so the thesis of Hegelianism, and I'll spell that for you, is Hegelianism. So Hegelianism, is a driving force here for Raskolnikov. Okay, these are, and here's what happens with it. So you have the old pawnbroker, and according to that theory, she is an active, she is a harmful thing, and her murder will just remove pain and blight from society if she gets murdered. So the second thing to be considered for this theory is this old pawnbroker has actually been involved in evil things. It's not that she's just evil. She's done evil things. The third thing is she has a lot of money. And instead of using it to give it to a monastery or to help feed the poor. And here we are again with the whole concept of poverty being a central thread here. She uses it to pay at church for her soul. You can give money to the church and somehow that will alleviate your sins. So instead of the money being used to help save families from poverty and destitution, she's given it to the church to pay for her wretched soul. Then the fourth thing is the person who murders her could use the money to help people who are actually in need, who are, he could use it to help humanity. So, according to this theory, one tiny crime can wipe out a lot of crime. One tiny crime would be wiped out by thousands of good deeds. That is the basis of the Hegelian, thank you, honey, antithesis. So, and if no one is willing to perform this murder, then there's no justice about it. That is how justice is served in that theory. So Raskolnikov had been considering this crime. And when he heard the conversation, then he determined that this was, you know, sort of confirmation. And then we go to the last part, chapter 7. This is just, we're just summarizing quickly here. You know, it ends with the murder of Alyona. But there's two murders, right? It's Alyona, and she's murdered with the blunt side of the axe, and then he just bludgeons her just to make sure that everything's done. Then, in contrast, you have the murder of Lizaveta, and that's done, you know, quickly, one swift stroke, with the sharp side of the axe. And in that dual murder, you have Raskolnikov's killed one person who is mean and wicked, and then that murder is premeditated, right? That proves his theory to himself. He's doing this thing for all humanity. The second murder, though, you have is Lizaveta, who's very warm, she's friendly. That's not premeditated. That is, you know, sort of accidental. But he compassionately kills her with one swift stroke. So these two murders represent Raskolnikov's split character. You've got, you know, he hardly ever thinks about Lizaveta's murder later, but he dwells on Alyona's murder because her death, you know, because she's so mean in his mind, that justifies his theories. He has to justify this criminal act in his own mind. But, you know, guilt has a way of just eating at you. And it can make you, you know, it's God's way of just tweaking. You know, you can't find any rest. You can't get away from it. And this is what Raskolnikov is going to suffer with. And in fact, I'm going to ask you as part of this lesson to watch a video on The Telltale Heart, which is about guilt and how, you know, we'll talk about it next week and how it applies to Crime and Punishment. So we see a lot of foreshadowing, a lot of symbolism as we finish part one. He's covered with blood. He sees the bucket. It's half full of water. He washes his hands, he washes the axe, and this whole cleaning ritual foreshadows his future redemption and salvation, his hopeful future salvation. Then we have that incessant ringing of the bell, which if you ever have a chance to like watch the BBC version, which hopefully we'll be able to see that in class, at least parts of it. Maybe we can see this part. The ringing of the bell is so incessant. It is so annoying. And he writes about it so well that we can feel Raskolnikov's feeling cornered by it, and the loudness of it to him, his oversensitivity to it. So you've got this ringing of the bell. And then he's hiding in a room freshly painted, which later on in the book, whenever he smells fresh paint, he swoons. He's overcome by the smell of fresh paint. And so we end part one with the murder and Raskolnikov's illness. And so the crime actually only takes up one part of the book, and the remainder of this novel is going to deal with the punishment. Thank you. guilt. You know, in Russian, so a lot of the names in Crime and Punishment, the way that their names translate, that in English we should, you know, English readers should know, but in Russian, it's very obvious to every Russian reader that a lot of these names have meaning. But in translation, the meanings are lost. But Raskolnik means schismatic, which means split. And Raskolnikov is a split character. And Marmalade is, you know, it's like a sort of sweet candy, kind of like marmalade, but Marmalade is a sweet candy. All right. So, the mystery at the heart of this novel is not who committed the crime, right? Because that's very evident right from the start. It's not even whether the criminal is going to be punished. That's not the heart of the matter here. Because he punishes himself from the moment he commits the murder. And he even dares others to do the same thing. The mystery revolves around the character of Raskolnikov himself. Dostoevsky alerts us to the character as mystery focus by naming his main character as he does, right? Because Raskolnik means split or schism in Russian. So you need to have your book because we're going to turn to a couple pages. Hopefully we can try to find them together. So one of the things that I love to find in literature is, you know, how this transcends to us. What do I get out of this literary classic? Literary characters or literary human beings are similar to, living human beings, like you and me, are similar to a good, fine character creation in a novel. What can you find about yourself in any of the characters? But just as I can't put you in a box and say, this is Stephen right here. This is who he is. I'm going to label him. He's good or bad. You can't do the same with a good literary character creation. You can't just simply categorize them the same way I can't simply categorize Ian. He's well-rounded. He's many-faceted. He's like an onion. And there are several deep and varied characters in Crime and Punishment, but Raskolnikov is truly the novel's principal split character. He has very conflicting impulses. And here are two quotes that are good examples, okay? Let's look at them. In part one, in chapter four, start with that. I wanted to say it was like around page 48 in my book. This is the one I have. So it's chapter four. Raskolnikov is, he's protecting a defenseless girl on the bench who has attracted the attention of a lecherous onlooker. And even as he's, you know, he wants to protect her, he almost immediately changes his mind and scorns his expression of concern. So it starts with, I saw myself. My word, this is not a 48. That's where it starts. I should have marked it. And that's okay. I'll just read it to you. But this is an example of his character. He says, Raskolnikov says, I saw myself, how he was watching her and following her. Only I hindered him. And now he's waiting until I go away. How can we keep him from her? How can we get her home? Then a moment later, taking some money out of his pocket to hand to the policeman, he says, here, hire a coachman and tell him to take her to her address. If only we could find out her address. So here we have Raskolnikov. The guy has no money hardly. He's so hungry. He's poverty stricken, yet he's going to give money to the policeman to pay for a taxi for this girl to get home. So what does that tell us about Raskolnikov? Well, I hope you're saying something like, it tells us he's a nice guy. He's thoughtful of others. But like 2 pages later, he says, completely oppositely, he says, he, meaning the policeman, kept my 20 kopecks. Raskolnikov said spitefully when he found himself alone. Well, let him. He'll take something from that one, too, and let the girl go with him, and that'll be the end of it. Why did I go meddling in all that? Who am I to help anyone? Do I have any right to help? Let them all gobble each other alive. What is it to me? What does that tell you about Raskolnikov? Right? He's not very nice. And so this is what you have throughout this book, this split character that I think many of us can relate with certain struggles in this. I want to do the right thing, but I don't always. Or it's not even that. It's I want to do the right thing, and then the next minute, it's not that I am forced into it. I really don't want to do the right thing. Something else that I want you to be paying attention to is at this time, there was a guy writing named Nietzsche. And I hope you're taking notes, Ian and Steven. Friedrich Nietzsche. So let me spell it for you. Friedrich, F-R-I-E-D, R-I-C-H, Nietzsche, N-I-E-T-Z-S-C-H-E. And Nietzsche lived 1844 to 1900. He was a German philosopher of the late 19th century who challenged the foundations of... Wait, I just want to check that out. Right, he was a German philosopher who challenged the foundations of Christianity and traditional morality. He was very interested in the enhancement of individual and cultural health and believed in life, creativity, power, which is very existential. Central to his philosophy is the idea of life affirmation, which to him meant honestly questioning all the doctrines that drain life's energies, no matter how socially prevalent these views might be. If it is taking you away, if it's taking your energy from who you really are, who you really could be, then according to Nietzsche, you would have to question that. So his philosophy, this just makes me crazy. His philosophy really did inspire so many cultural figures and from all different kinds of walks of life, social revolutionaries, painters, novelists, dancers. His father was a town minister. His uncle and grandfathers were ministers. His paternal grandfather was a Protestant scholar who wrote a book actually affirming the everlasting survival of Christianity. So when Nietzsche was nearly 5 years old, and the reason I'm talking to you about Nietzsche is that he was, his philosophy was very popular at the time Dostoevsky was writing. Nietzsche would say that he was influenced by Dostoevsky. Dostoevsky would say, nothing I ever wrote should influence you, because he didn't agree with Nietzsche's thought line. So anyway, Nietzsche was 5 years old. His father died from a brain ailment. And then 6 months later, his two-year-old brother died. So he lived with his mother, his grandmother, and two sisters. And when he was 14, he went to his first he went to a first-rate boarding school, which had a very rigid educational atmosphere. He was, a well-off guy. He had money. And so, like Confucius, Basho, he had all his money, but he's sort of rejecting it. Whereas Basho actually did reject it. Nietzsche never really comes that far. He struggles, I think, with his social place in the world, and he does have this. Anyway, the long and the short of it is, he became a very popular philosophy writer, a philologist. He studied at a Swiss university. He took a professorial position there when he was 24 years old. He taught as a university professor in philosophy at this Swiss university, the University of Basel, until he was 35, when he just became so ill. He had these terrible migraines that would make him throw up. He couldn't see, and so that's why he had to quit working there. So then he took on this sort of gypsy-like existence where he just went and stayed all around Europe, not longer than 3 months in any one place. He would stay with friends or, family. I mean, honestly, Florence, Venice, all through Italy, all through the Alps. So, and this is when these sort of nomadic years is when he wrote a lot of his big writings. Very anti-Christ-like. With titles like Beyond Good and Evil, Twilight of the Idols, The Antichrist. Anyway, he ends up in Turin and has a mental breakdown, which left him as an invalid for the rest of his life. Some people would say that he had syphilis. Some people say he had a genetic disorder passed down from his father. Some people say that he had a weakened nervous system and, had this slow mental breakdown. Other people say he had like a hereditary stroke disorder. The exact cause of Nietzsche's incapacitation remains unclear, but he ends up at a home with his sister. She moves in with him and takes care of him for the rest of his years, and she takes all his writings and organizes them and makes like this little museum where other philosophers from around the world, because Nietzsche was very popular during his lifetime, they would come and sit at his feet, or they just wanted to observe him. It's insane, but they wanted to go and observe him in his surroundings and learn from him, from this observation. So she had this whole collection of his manuscripts in his residence, and for 3 years or several years, people would come and just sit at his feet to listen to this philosopher's great views. Finally, in August 25th, 1900, he died just as he was getting ready to turn 56. I know I said 60. This is a, I thought it was 56. Apparently, he had a stroke, pneumonia. So there's two of the biggest things I want you to remember about Nietzsche, was that he was he had two big ideas. One is that God is dead. That statement has been become one of his best known remarks. God is dead was said by Friedrich Nietzsche. The other one is the Übermensch. Ubermensch. So the Übermensch is an important concept to understanding Nietzsche's thought. Translated, it means the overman or the superman or the superhuman. And this develops the concept of nihilism, which is a denial of all authority, because you're in control of your own life. It's the belief that existing social and political institutions must be destroyed to ensure progress. It's in favor of extreme individualism, which I don't see how that can possibly work ever. But this is something that Nietzsche and his philosopher pals all sat around and thought about while they drank their coffee, I guess. So, the Übermensch. The term Übermensch was a favorite of Hitler and the whole Nazi regime, which basically hijacked Nietzsche's work and sort of distorted his text as a philosophical foundation for their ideas. But their concept of the Übermensch was racial in nature. That's not how Nietzsche thought of it. He thought of it more as there are some people who are above the law, who are above everything. There are some people who can get away with things, can do things that not everybody else can do. And this was the Übermensch. So Nietzsche, we're going to talk more about Nietzsche next week and his impact on that time period and Dostoevsky's impact on Nietzsche. Okay. So I'm going to give you a few things to do this week. You are going to read the Sermon on the Mount from the KJV. You're going to have a video to watch. I want you to write that worldview. Don't kill yourself over it. More than anything, I don't care about all the writing requirement checklist as you write it. But what I do want you to do is really think. Think about what influences the way you live, how you make your decisions. We all have a worldview. Remember Yoko Ono. I mean, it's the color, it's your rose-colored glasses. It's the glasses that you see your life through, and it influences everything that you do. So I want you to really analyze that. And, you know, if you can't quite determine what influences you, maybe what you wish would influence you. You could build your worldview. And then as you make decisions and choices in your life, measure it against your worldview and see if it's measuring up. I think that's all of it because I'm going to ask you to, you know, spend some time now to, which should be in your email, to watch a video. And that would be the end of our lesson for today. I'm sorry I'm not with you guys. I hope you're going to enjoy Crime and Punishment. It's a fantastic book, a wonderful literary masterpiece, and a classic, a timeless classic. All right, and then I will see you next week. And I'm trying to think. Oh, you know what? As we approach Christmas, I like to do like a little Christmas celebration. Not much, because we really don't have a lot of time for that stuff in the core classes. But I like to do a t-shirt exchange. So, because, you know, we all like a good t-shirt. So be on the lookout. You can go to Salvation Army or Goodwill. You can go into your drawers or your brother's drawer and find a really fun t-shirt with a really fun saying on it or something just really cool. And that's what we'll do is we'll have a t-shirt exchange. Don't go spend a lot of money on a t-shirt. You can get them for a buck at Salvation Army. And you can get them for free in your brother's drawer. Just be thinking about it. That's what we'll be doing in December. Have a good week, you guys.